Good afternoon again, everybody. After a little technical problem, we are back at Kiosk Radio live today with a special guest, which is Martin Meissionnier. Hello, Martin.
Hey.
We are here to give also some, you know, information about this incredible French producer. I would like to start by giving also some background information about the way I came to meet Martin. A few months ago, a friend from Brussels, I mean, that used to live in Brussels, contacted me on Facebook saying, hey, I have an uncle who was like, who was busy with music and recently started DJing again. Can I put him in touch with you? And I said, of course, let's meet this guy and see what he does. And I had no idea about your background. And I discovered back then that actually you produce basically a third of my record collection, Martin. And you've been collaborating with some really incredible artists. Can you tell us more about the artists you've been working with in the late in the 70s and 80s?
I worked with Don Cherry. Was a big master for me. Work with John Lee Hooker. I worked with Fela Kuti, King Sunny Ade, Papa Wemba, Ray Lima, Manu Dibango.
Yes, some like total legends in like from jazz to African, of course, music. And how did you stumble upon these artists? How did you discover them? And when did you became interested in their sound?
Well, I mean, I was a big fan already. I mean, I've always been listening to black music all the time. I mean, like from very, very early on, I used to. First, I had an uncle in Congo, and my grandma came back from Congo when I was like 6 or 7, 8 years old, and she brought me a drum from Congo and music from Congo. So it's like I had that idea of there's something interesting there, and also. My brothers, my older brothers, and they had left the house, and they left some, Stax records and R&B records and John Lee Hooker and Miles Davis. And, so I was really intrigued by that music.
And from being intrigued, then you became the producer of all this incredible artists from the past century, some of the best artists of the past century, I would say. And how did that happen?
At that time, especially in African music, not many people were interested. So I would go see the musician and say, "Well, I'd love to work with you, really, and help you." So, I met Don Cherry at one gig. That was a gig of the Art Ensemble of Chicago, and Don Cherry was there, and I told him, "Well, I'd like to work with you," and he said, "Well, yes, Wow. And I started organizing concerts with him, and then I was carrying his suitcase, and I became his manager for 3-4 years.
And that's when you started meeting all the artists.
And then Don introduced me to other people, and then I remember also one day for John Lee Hooker, at the time I was not producer, I was really a promoter. And a friend from Canada called me and say, "I saw John Lee Hooker playing in a pizzeria." And I say, "So I picked the number for you." So I called the agent and I organized 3 tours with John Lee. And, nobody was interested at that time. In America, when you're not in the chart anymore, your price drop and nobody's interested with you. And so it was fascinating. And so I used to say, okay, well, every time you have an artist that you're interested, you just take the train or you fly and just meet him.
And then I can say you basically helped some of these artists to be back on the charts and introducing also a new kind of sound. I would probably take a little break and listen already to one of the records that honestly I've been listening to the most in my life. Is one of my favorite records, really, from King Sunny Ade that you produced. And the track in question is Synchro System. We're gonna listen to it for the next few minutes, and then we'll be back with some more questions. I feel like we could really talk for hours, Martin.
Synchro, synchro system, synchro system.
System. Okay, so we're back after this amazing track, Synchro System, and while we were listening to it here in the studio, me and Martin were talking about, you know, how his sound also influenced, in the production, the artists he worked with, and he was telling me about, for instance, some of the instruments and the synthesizer that he has used. Can you tell us a bit more about that, Martin?
Well, I used to have a Prophet 5, and we were listening to with Godwin Logie, who was the sound engineer. We were just listening at that time a lot to George Clinton, because he had this new single was Loopzilla, and which was quite incredible. And I wanted Synchro System. I just thought, well, we could make it sound like have that Loopzilla feel. So I just decided to double the bass drum with a big fat bass sound of the Prophet 5, and stick that on the track, and that gives the feel.
That worked big time. and I also while we were talking, discovered that actually, I mean, you didn't produce that many records before. Actually, you were quite new to the production.
Yeah.
And you were like mainly working at Island as a manager, and then you had this like shift from management to actual music production. Can you tell us
I had produced two albums before, but not on my own. I had produced a Don Cherry album, and also an album with a Turkish band called Oriental Wind, mm-hmm. that I'm quite proud of, because it was quite astonishing. It was a Turkish kind of jazz feel, mm-hmm. and then I had not much knowledge of the studio, and basically Island Records, Chris Blackwell told him, well, why don't you give the Sunny Ade first album, that was Juju Music, why don't you give it to produce to Wally Badaru or someone that and Chris said no, you did the job very well until now, so why don't you mix it with Godwin Logie, who's a house engineer, and is going to help you. And so Godwin helped me. He helped me so much that we spent about the next 5 or 6 years together. As we said, sometimes we were seeing each other more than we were seeing our wives.
Great. And to move to another artist you've been collaborating with closely, and if I understood correctly, you met him like at an early age as well, Ray Lema. Like long have you been knowing each other?
Ray Lema, I didn't know him much at all. He was a common friend, who was Jean-François Bizot, who was the owner of the magazine Actuel, and he had taken Ray Lema under his wing. And he wanted, he had produced an album with Ray, and he was suggesting, after listening to my work with Sunny Ade, he said, why don't you do an album with Ray? And
this was the album.
And that was the album.
So,
that was the album. I must say, because of the record cover, had been the police told me to actually. I had some trouble with the police.
Okay, yeah. So that wasn't allowed back then to have.
No,
okay.
Absolutely not.
That's a crazy story.
Yes, and but basically the idea of this album was really interesting, because Ray was a real specialist of traditional African music. He's a great knowledge. And basically we had this Fairlight computer, sampler computer. It was, I had access to a Fairlight, so I suggested to do the album, instead of doing the album with a band, is just to do the album just the two of us,
with electronic, with drum computers,
electronics, in 1983, and so because I was really excited to see also how Ray would program it with me. And it was terribly exciting to look at him, and I learned so much looking at him about programming and into African music, mm-hmm. So because Ray is, we would go from 4/4 to 6/8, different time signature, and put the accent here or there. So it was a real, for
polyrhythmic,
me. Polyrhythmic. And it was all, for me, was I learned so much doing that album.
And we're going to listen now to one of the tracks from the album, which is Popleio.
Yes.
But a very special edition of this track, if I'm not mistaken. Can you tell me, explain a bit more?
Yes, it's a dub that I actually like more than the track on the album. It's an outtake, and so it's... it's a special thing for you.
And it's unreleased.
Absolutely unreleased.
Absolutely unreleased. Amazing. So let's enjoy this for the next few minutes.
Sangana
This was Ray Lema.
And it was an initiation music from Congo, from the Luba tribe.
Okay. Like for initiation from ritual?
Ritual, yeah. Okay. Initiation music from a ritual turned into electronics.
Incredible. And yeah, you were saying that Tony Allen was also part of this particular track.
So I must say, you know, Ray Lema played the keyboard line in one take, and Tony Allen came and joined, and he played the Simmons drum. Just Tony.
Okay, fantastic. And you just discovered, actually, you had a band with Tony Allen in a bit later.
Yeah, early 90s. 10 years, early 90s. You know, we had this band backing up Amina. She was a French Tunisian singer, and Tony was on drums, and there was Cheikh Tidiane Seck on keyboards as well, and some phenomenal Tunisian musicians as well.
Amazing. So you've been moving from sub-Saharan Africa, to the northern part of Africa, let's say, and then also to way further part of the world, which leads me also to the next artist I wanted to briefly discuss with you, which is Yasuaki Shimizu,
yes.
A Japanese artist that has been widely reissued lately on all his several projects, one of them being Maria as well, which is like a legendary Japanese project. And you actually had a collaboration, and you produced one of the albums of Yasuaki on Crumb Discs. Am I correct?
No, sorry. No, it was on. This was I think RCA Japan or something.
Okay. How did you meet Yasuaki, and how did that collaboration came across?
Well, Yasuaki came to Paris, and he was actually living in Paris at the time. And he had doing some soundtrack for Juliette Berthaud and something like that. And I don't know. I know I was working at Radio Nova at the time, and I was I was DJ at the time, and I was doing also the habillage d'antenne, you know, making all the jingles and stuff. And that was a lot of fun because there was no advert, and the radio was kicking at the time. And I don't know how I met Yasuaki, but we actually met, and he wanted to do an album with me, and I was really excited to work with him too, because at the time he had the S900, the sampler, Akai, and he was incredible at it.
He was mastering it.
It was like, you know, it was because the S900 was really a pain in the ass to work with.
and in those years, several of these like electronic machines were like incredibly geeky, let's say. Yeah.
And at the time I was DJing with vinyl, which I don't what I don't do anymore. Mm-hmm. On the record you hear there's the track you're going to play, I think there's some vinyl samples I had done.
Okay, nice.
And it was a lot of fun. We had fun, and the thing is, like, we had no idea what we were going to do before we started. You know, we were working on programming together. And actually, it's funny because Amina, who was my girlfriend at the time, and I knew she was we had just met, and I knew she was a singer, and she wanted to try on one track. And I say, well, please go and sing. And Yasuaki and I, we were absolutely blown away by the vocal she put. And so that's how I decided to produce her. And she was extremely successful afterwards.
Incredible. Yeah. So and the connection came also through Yasuaki Shimizu.
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. And the thing with... the singer that's singing on this track, Tamari Tamari, is Wazis Diop, who was also a friend. He was really a friend, and we told him, well, you know, come and join, and let's, you know, write the track together.
Amazing. So let's listen to this track, Tamari Tamari, from produced by Martin Meissonnier and Yasuaki Shimizu. And can you remind me the title of the album? Is Subliminal, right?
Subliminal.
Yeah. super. Enjoy.
Bye.
amazing. This was Tamare Tamare from Yasuaki Shimizu. And we were just saying that, I mean, you can really hear your previous influence from all the, you know, artists from, you know, Nigeria, Cameroon, DRC, all the artists that you've worked with. You can really feel the influence also on this particular record, but adding, of course, the more like Oriental or like a Japanese side to it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's... That's what's exciting. It's what, you know, the mixing of that was really interesting. And also you have to see, the, you know, at that time, you know, Papa Wemba was also going to Japan. And so we, you know, went on tour with him in Japan. And that was really interesting. We actually did some live things with Papa Wemba and Japanese traditional singers in Japan, and electro mixed and everything. Yeah.
And in this kind of mix, there is always, we were just agreeing, there is always the best and most interesting music.
Absolutely, yeah. It's but we were experimenting. It was really experimentation. Sometimes it was complicated because, you know, we were trying stuff and sometimes it didn't work exactly as the way we wanted, you know. For instance, you know, when we did this Japanese tour with Papa Wemba and Japanese singers, you know, it was incredibly difficult because all the synthesizers, we had differences of levels between sounds, so the sound engineer was going crazy. but you know, it was fun. We were trying.
Yeah, you were trying with great results, I have to say. Just to, let's say, end this like a little let's say background history about your own career, focusing on the past. Now we're gonna move soon to the more present stuff, but I wanted to tell one last thing. I was saying at the very beginning of this show that I have most of your records and productions. And you just mentioned actually that another pretty important artist of the past century confessed that he basically had all your records, and you actually came to have a collaboration with him. Can you unveil the artist I'm talking about? I'm referring to.
Well, you know, it's one day. Yes, I went to concert with Robert Plant, and you know, you know, I always liked Led Zeppelin, and he actually said, "Well, man, you know, I follow your work." And I said, "Oh, really?" And I didn't know, you know, I had no idea that. And I realized how interested Led Zeppelin were with
in your music.
No, not in my music. Okay, in music in general. It's like it was fascinating to see that they had studied Indian music, Moroccan music, and they were really into rhythms. And so he asked me to help them with rhythm because they didn't have any drummer anymore. And so that's you know, that's how we came to work.
And then you collaborated on one album
yeah.
Where also Amina was involved, or like
no, Amina was not involved with that, but
you basically brought the more like rhythmic
singing to, you know, I mean, like Arabic rhythms into this album called No Quarter.
Okay, amazing. So to move back to the present, I mean, I know that you took a break from music at some point, and you stopped being as prolific as you were in the 80s. I mean, you were impossible to stop, I think, in the 80s. And then you started focusing more like on film and cinema and television. And recently you rediscovered the passion for music and you started DJing again. I know I had great feedback about like performance at Transmusical last year, for instance. Can you tell us how you became interested again and why?
Well, it really comes that in the middle of the 90s, even the beginning of the 90s, record company weight was really very heavy, and I thought it was less and less interesting to produce records because the record company were pushing for very, very commercial styles, which I just felt I was not meant to do this job because I, you know, otherwise I could go work for a factory or something. But so I thought it was becoming very boring to produce music at the time because of that pressure. So I just decided to do films because, you can travel, meet people, interesting people, go all over the world. So I thought it was more exciting. And I could still meet my friend musicians as I was traveling, so, and meet, discover other musics as well. So it was good, and I made some great encounters with fantastic musicians. I didn't work with Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, but actually we had the project to work together, but he died before. But actually, I met him and I did a little film with him, and different approach. And I decided to become an amateur, mm-hmm. and not to be a professional anymore. And I thought it was, and I still produced a few records. I produced the Rye Meets Reggae record with Gregory Isaacs and Tim. But it was really more like an amateur. Mm-hmm. Way in the sense that I really did it for fun.
Lately you then started again being more interested and active again as a DJ.
Yes.
And also as a producer, you started like also releasing again. We're going to talk very soon about your latest release.
Well, I did the Sheun Kuti first album and then the University of Gnawa, and now I remixed all this Congo stuff for Cram Disc for the Kinshasa 78, Kinshasa 78, and 78, or
or and you name it.
And basically, but I did that really for my DJ set.
Tell us a bit more. So, just to give some little background information, this record that was it's just out on Cram Discs, it's about like some reconstruction that you did to a work of another French producer that is also your friend. Or
yes, he was my when I started in the 70s, it was my first job. Was to work with Bernard Treton, who was a producer at France Musique, and it was really my first music job. And he hired me to be a producer, and I was like 17 or 18, And I was working with him on programs and stuff, he had gone to Congo, that was there at the time, and to do some training.
Yeah, training of sound engineering.
Sound engineer, and basically he loved these bands that were playing in the streets, and he recorded them. And
put together a work that has been massively overlooked, basically.
Exactly.
And it was then rediscovered mainly through the help of a very close collaborator of Cram Disc, which is Vincent Kenis.
Vincent, yeah.
And Vincent then went into this like struggle to find the Konono number one of the of the bands that you can find in this latest release as well, that then became the founders of the Congotronics and all the related sound, let's say. What did you reconstruct? What did you add in this like productions from Kinshasa 78?
Bernard gave me all the original tapes, so, and I fiddled with it to make it sound bigger for a good DJ set. and basically,
so they're like more dance floor proof, basically.
Well, they were really dance floor, because that's dance floor music.
Exactly.
But I just try to respect the rhythm and make it just sound fatter, and more just more efficient sound wise. So, but I really respected the tracks, except for one that I, the Konono one, which I went really over the top in store just to, But I actually created that remix just for the Transmusicale, And actually, I did it on my laptop.
can you play one of these, like find easily one of these latest tracks
of the
release, perhaps?
Yes, I should. Yeah. Let me.
Otherwise, I can also, in the meantime.
I'm frozen.
I know. It's called. Some people call it the sauna, but today it's not really the case here. It's like 8 degrees inside.
yeah, I got it.
So
okay.
Voila. So we can listen to one of these tracks. Can you also tell me which one we're gonna listen to?
It's a Root of K. Root of Konono.
And so we are back with Martin Meissionnier. We were just discussing contemporary music, and as I was saying, Martin found again his like interest and passion for music in the more recent years. I wanted to know from you, Martin, why did you refine this passion, and what are your contemporary artists that really talk to you lately? If there is some sounds or some particular.
Actually, you know, I went to do a film in South Africa about dance about 5 years ago. And then I met all these guys from, DJ Shimza, Da Capo, with Kulo the Song, and, I didn't meet Black Coffee then, but, you know, I mean, all these guys were there, and it's like, it was mind-blowing, because, you know, what they were doing was so exciting. And then I could hear, you know, my friend Benjamin from, he has this label in Ghana called Aquaba, and he's producing incredible records. And then I could hear Arabic music, you know, the electro shabi from Egypt. And, I hear fantastic music coming from everywhere. I see, you know, in Brussels you have Amare Toit, which I love. Yeah.
Sofiane came here for a live set. We are big fans of Amare Toit.
Sofiane became a bit nice, very good friend now.
Fantastic.
And and then you have also DJ Hula, DJ Nouri, DJ. You know, you have Dina Abdel Wahab. I mean, you have all these incredible talents.
That probably are closer to what you were doing, or like
exactly, yeah,
in the 80s as
yeah,
a producer
and,
as well,
and producing phenomenal records. So I'm just thrilled, and some artists. Now I'm extremely happy to.
So you play some of these productions in your DJ sets, basically.
Exactly.
So you try to play. I mean, because there is a huge. There was a huge, nostalgic. It was a huge nostalgic decade in many ways, in music terms. I think.
Yeah.
There has been a lot of course of new sounds, but there is also been a lot of research more on the past.
Yes.
What is your approach to this like more nostalgic?
Or you prefer
focusing on today, right?
I like the new stuff. Really like the new stuff, and
perhaps you can like select. One or two tracks that really you find interesting.
Okay. Well, I find you a remix by DJ Hula, which I love, and so you're going to take that.
Come on, let me see you work, let me see you work. Let me see you work, let me see you work it. Let me see you work, let me see you work. Let me see you work, let me see you work. Come on, let me see you work, let me see you work. Let me see you work, let me see you work it. Let me see you work, let me see you work. Let me see you work, let me see you work. Come on. We'll be right back.
So, Martin, tell us a bit more about this track we just listened to.
Well, this track is from Hula, G H O U L A, and he's a composer and a DJ living in Paris. He's from Tunisia, and he's
Like Amari 808,
like Amari 808, yeah. And he's I think they're playing a gig in Brussels together actually.
Okay.
This week.
Okay. Oh wow.
So I think so. So you should check
it out. I will check it out. I wasn't aware. I admit my ignorance.
Hula is incredible as a DJ.
Wow. Fantastic.
So just.
And so just before we leave you, Martin, tell us a bit more about your, you know, next steps, next projects, anything exciting coming up in the future.
Well, you know, I'm really enjoying, so, you know, mixing all this stuff together. You know, what's exciting now is really with this new electronics, now we can really play four or five tracks together, mix it together and create new music. So it's really exciting. So I'm having lots of fun mixing stuff, you know. Like, for instance, now I'm going to mix some Egyptian track with some jungle. It's always fun.
Fantastic. So, yeah, that mix we were talking about, it's becoming even easier in a way, and also wider on today's music.
And you can
why it makes it.
Yeah, you can really go crazy. So I think, you know, DJ sets are becoming really, I mean, especially, you know, I think I recognize myself very well in this style, because we can really go to some real serious trends in the gigs.
Fantastic. So let's listen to the last track. Okay. Can you tell us the title before?
I wish I could. Mates Grabash.
Fantastic. So we're going to listen to that song.
Thank you, Porta from Egypt.
Thank you very much, Martin, for being with us. It was
a big pleasure
and honor to meet and discuss with you.
Thank you so much.
See you soon.
Good luck, Yemen. 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 Good luck
And voilà, this is the end. Thanks again, Martin. And it's now time for DJ Quack, which I hope is in the house. Quack, are you there? See you next time.